darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Where you to count my sinful ways? How could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze.
Well, good morning, church, and welcome everyone to our online service of worship here at Newburgh United Methodist. My name is Steve McCoy, and I am the lead pastor here today. We especially want to wish all of our dads out there and those who are like dads to us a happy Father's Day as we come to you in your home and you worship with us from wherever you are today. I want to remind you that Newburgh is a reconciling congregation that welcomes and affirms all people. And especially on this day, we are affirmative of all of those who are celebrating Pride Month here in the month of June. And as we stand in solidarity for those who are seeking and actively working for equality in our country at this time. We have a couple of announcements that we want to highlight this morning, but before we get to those, please take a moment and look at our online worship page at our website, newburghumc.org. It's there you can find our online Connect card and you can register your presence here with us today. If you're watching us right now on Facebook Live, just give us a hello or a shout out to let us know that you are here today. As you're on our webpage, you can also look at our online giving page, which has several options for you to continue to give electronically during this time, which is very important for continuing to support the ministries of Newburgh Church. As I said, a couple of announcements. The first one is that our blood drive is coming up a week from today on Sunday that will be held on site here at Newburgh in Guthrie Hall. An appointment is required, so you do need to go to our webpage and sign up for your space there for the blood drive. Versity will be making sure that everything is clean properly, proper sanitation, and proper physical distancing for protecting everybody's health. Blood is so important still, and especially now as donations are down. So if you are able to help, please go to the Newburgh website, and you can also call to the office this week between the hours of 9 a.m. and 1 p.m. and reserve your spot there as well. So we look forward to your help there. Also, a week from Tuesday, on June the 30th, we'll be having our second online town hall gathering. We hope that you'll join us then as we talk more about what it might look like for Newburgh to start the reopening process here in these summer months leading into the fall. We'll have a time for sharing where we are at this point in line with the governor's order and what the bishop is expecting to for us, and also how some of our other ministries might be affected by this as well. So please do mark your calendars for 7 p.m. on June the 30th and join us for our town hall. All of our other online ministries are continuing. Tune in tomorrow for my Monday Minute. Also, you can tune in during the week for various activities. Our online Get Fed is done for the year, but we'll be substituting that with other online activities during the week. You can also tune in for Saturdays with Mrs. Karen for our children's ministry and our Friday podcast series, Let's Talk About That. And we're looking forward to bringing those to you as well. There are a couple of other announcements that we hope that you will go to our webpage and take a look at. But for now, as we prepare to worship, let's settle down and get comfy and get ready to have an encounter with God this morning. As we do that, and acknowledging the day that it is, I open us up in worship today with this prayer as we celebrate Father's Day today. So please join me and let us be in an attitude of prayer. Holy God, on this day, hear this prayer for our fathers. Today we pray for our fathers everywhere who have given us life and love, that we might show them respect and love. We pray for our fathers who have lost a child, that their family might give them hope, and their family and friends support and console them. We pray for men who may not have children of their own, but act like a father to someone in need of advice, of support, of nurturing, and of love. We pray for stepfathers who have assumed the role with love and joy, who have loved the children of another as their own, and have created a new family. We pray for adoptive fathers who have heard the call of God to lovingly step forward to care for those who are in need of a parent. We pray for fathers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to the needs of their children, and who have not sustained their families. We pray for fathers who struggle with temptation, violence, or addiction, and for those who do harm, and for those whom they have harmed. We pray for new fathers who are full of hope, for longtime fathers who are full of wisdom, and for fathers yet to be, and fathers soon to be. Holy God, hear our prayer for the fathers of your church, for those who have shaped our lives without calamity or of family or of kinship, but for those who have taught us and guided us and shaped us and molded us into the servants of Christ our Lord. Holy God, in your wisdom and your love, you have made all things. Bless these men that they may be strengthened as Christian fathers in whatever forms they are present. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth, and grant that we, their sons and daughters, honor them always in a spirit of profound love and grace. Grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us address our joys and concerns. Ed and Judy Dobson have asked for prayers for her brother, Jim Cook, who is having trouble controlling diabetes, and also for Jim's wife, Cynthia, who was hospitalized after surgery for a broken leg. They are also asking for prayers for their daughter's father-in-law, Bob Fournier, who is having heart issues. Kay Stewart will be returning to the Cleveland Clinic on Tuesday for scans to see how successful her recent cancer surgery was. Pray for Kate and for her parents, Bill and Judy, as they await the results. Janet Wyna, Nancy Boyd's longtime friend, has been diagnosed with breast cancer and exploring treatment options. Faisal Ramprasad, Mazen Hooper's brother, is now in a rehab facility and physical therapy following a stroke. Betty Wilson is at home taking medications for a flare-up in AFib. She will be seeing a doctor again in 3 weeks. Carl Schroeder, friend of Linda Podesto, continues his battle for cancer. Lori Pierce continues to deal with the effects of a brain tumor. Vince Potestio is recovering from foot surgery. April Bertolino, daughter of Sharon and Gerald Phillies, and sister of Autumn Kovac, continues in cancer treatments. Al Thurnau is undergoing another round of chemotherapy for leukemia, and Sean Patel, the three-year-old nephew of Pastor Steve's neighbor, is at U of M Mott Hospital, diagnosed with a rare brain tumor. Let us now join in our pastoral prayer. Loving God, we give thanks for the men of virtue who have touched our lives, and those who've shown us kindness, courage, generosity, truth, compassion, faith, and love. Bless all the sons and brothers and fathers and grandfathers who reveal a glimpse of your loving presence on earth. Holy and living God, in you we live and move and exist. In you we find our shelter and strength. In you our hearts are being filled with joy each morning. In you we sing praises with a new song. In you we trust that your promises are the way. Like the disciples in Act first chapter, experiencing the time in between, witnessing ascension of Jesus Christ, and awaiting the descent of the Holy Spirit, a time in between, staring into the heaven and staying in one place. During our time in between, we wait with hope for you as the source of every hope. We wait with patience for you. Timing is always perfect. We wait with prayer for you, are listening intently. We wait with praise for you and take all our anxieties as we cast them on you. During this time, we pray especially for those who are graduates with uncertain hindering their future, those who have lost their jobs and finding ways to meet their financial needs, those who have lost loved ones and their funeral services are limited or postponed, those who are fighting against addiction and unable to meet with their recovery groups, those who feel fear or hate as crimes and incidents rise. During this time, O God, enter into our sorrows, worries, addictions, financial burdens, fears, and injustices. Fill us with your grace, hope, and joy abundantly. Turn each home into a place of peace, unity, and love for each other. Renew our hearts and minds to seek the knowledge of your mercy and love. Help our souls to be united in incessant prayer. To all those mentioned in our hearts and all those mentioned aloud, we ask your blessings and your healing hand. Keep them forever in the palm in your hand. Let it be so. And now let us pray the words that the Lord taught us in the Gospel of Luke. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Spirit of God, unseen as the wind, gentle as is the dove, teach us the truth and help us believe. Show us the Savior's love. You spoke to us long, long ago, gave us the written word. We read it still, needing its truth. Through it, God's voice is heard. Spirit of God, unseen as the wind, gentle as is the dove. Teach us the truth and help us believe. Show us the Savior's love. Without your help, we fail. fail our Lord. We cannot live His way. We need Your power, we need Your strength, following Christ each day. Spirit of God, unseen as the wind, gentle as is the dove, teach us the truth and help us believe. Show us the Savior's love.
Let us give thanks for our offerings. Wondrous God of the universe, who finds time to whisper Your love to us, we come to Your altar with grateful hearts. When You speak Your love into our quiet moments, it is the most precious gift of all. It is not a gift for us to hold and hide, but to proclaim from the housetops. May the gifts we offer You this morning proclaim Your love loudly to a world that often feels forgotten. We pray this in the name of Your Son, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
This is a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And a man lame from birth was being carried in. People would lay him daily at the gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate, so that he could ask for alms from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked them for alms. Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver or gold, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Jumping up, he stood and began to walk, and he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God, and they recognized him as the one who used to sit and ask for alms at the Beautiful Gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. This is the word of God for all God's people. Thanks be to God.
Good morning again, church, and again, a happy Father's Day to everybody who is out there. And we're glad to be with you as we worship together this morning, again, from wherever we are, joining us online, as we continue our series today called A Leader Like Peter. And we've been looking how Peter has evolved as not only a disciple, but then to an apostle and the leader of the church at its early days of its formation. Now, as we come to today's story that we just heard read from Gary from Acts chapter 3, I want to start off by telling you of another story. It's a story of about an employer that shall remain nameless, I should say, in order to protect the guilty, if you will. But during that time of year that everybody loves, which is employee evaluation time, both the supervisors and the employees would fill out their forms rating yourself and your employee on several redundant questions on a scale of 1 to 5. They even had a breakdown of the percentages of what those 1 to 5 numbers meant. Now, in my own opinion, they probably should have done letter grades like in school and they'd have been better off, but I digress. One employee marked themselves down with actually having all 5s in their categories. And the reason that they did that was it said that on a scale of 1 to 5, it meant that they performed this task between 90% of the time to 100% of the time. Now, they weren't perfect, of course, but at least they gave themselves a 90% in every category. So most people worked with this individual actually agreed with that as well. Then they got to their supervisor's review, which, let's just say, did not give them all fives. Far from it, as a matter of fact. In fact, this supervisor said to them, "I don't know how you could give yourself even one five, let alone all fives. Nobody gets a five on my form because only God is perfect." Let that sink in for a minute. Now, let alone the fact that that's not even what the criteria was on the evaluation of being exactly 100% perfect, it also, that attitude does not really inspire much confidence in anybody. No matter how well you do your job, you're never going to meet expectations, let alone exceed them. And quite frankly, if that's going to be the case, who really wants to work for anybody like that? Now, there's always room for improvement, how to learn how to do new things, needing correction, and when mistakes are made, fixing those mistakes, and those are going to be made. But if you want to cultivate someone to be the best that they can possibly be, you can't do that simply by tearing them down alone and telling them that they cannot do and that they should not do something and telling them only what they are not good at. In the same way, people also do need to be pushed to be better than they already are. And the thing is that there is no 1-to-5 scale that will ever be able to quantify all of that. You see, that type of encouragement, that type of learning, it builds up over time. It grows. And becoming a leader in any field requires not only learning and growing, but also for many people, it requires someone who has been there before to tell them that they can and they should do something and that they have the ability to do something. And in fact, they would be selling themselves and others short if they did not do this. Now, I don't know if this company still evaluates that way anymore or where those people who were involved in that conversation were at the time, but I do know that it made an impression on me and everyone else, particularly about how not to raise somebody up. Now, I think there are a few things that we can take away from this, but I want to take some time today to talk about a few individual points, mainly. Yes, that is true. God is, quote unquote, only perfect. But thank you, Jesus, we are not measured in our faith on a scale of 1-to-5. Also, we make assumptions about the word perfection that can limit us in our own ability to transform our lives and our own ability to transform the world. As Christians who are moving on to perfection, believing that we have the power to do so is a natural extension of our faith. And yes, all of these things are very much a part of our teaching in the United Methodist Church from our Wesleyan heritage, coming directly, in fact, from John Wesley himself. Now, Wesley, of course, did not come up with this on his own. And as we have been sharing over this season of Pentecost, Peter provides for us a great example of how he learned and his evolution in becoming a strong leader. In our passage today from Acts 3, we have the example of Peter and John who heal the lame beggar at the gate of the temple and doing so in the name of Jesus. And what I find interesting is what Peter says to him. He says that, "I have no gold or silver to give you, but what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." And he does. Peter, with the full confidence in the power and authority that Jesus gave to them, did not hesitate to offer this man something that he never believed was possible, the ability to walk and to not have to beg anymore. But as you may have figured out, it wasn't always this way. Peter, in particular, initially never had much confidence in his own ability. And we have seen that before from his lack of understanding about what Jesus must do in order to accomplish his mission here on earth, to Peter's lack of faith in his own abilities. Particularly if we look at Luke chapter 9, starting in verse 41, Jesus returns to his disciples and the crowds that are gathered are there. And then Jesus is confronted by a man whose son is, by modern standards, an epileptic. And this man says to Jesus, "Have mercy on my son. I brought him to your disciples," Peter included, "and they could not heal him." And Jesus says, in what can only be interpreted, as a moment of extreme frustration, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you? Bring your son to me." And Jesus heals him out of frustration. Now, the subtext in this passage, which they did not have our English idioms for today, is, why is it that if you want something done right, you've got to do it yourself? Jesus essentially looks to the disciples and said, "You have this power. Why don't you use it?" Matthew's version even has Jesus telling the disciples that they could not heal the boy because they had no faith. Even if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, a tiny mustard seed, you could do anything. You could move a mountain, but you could not. Jesus is a little bit beyond frustrated here, which happens more often than not with his disciples. But notice, even out of that frustration, he is trying to push them and to challenge them into being more than they think they could be. He continues to teach them, and he never gives up on them. Jesus never gives up on us either. But we also must be able to see what happened there and what they and what Peter took away from that experience. If nothing else, see that they needed to believe and to trust. And here we see that in the book of Acts, Peter finally does see. He does believe, and he trusts. And we can trust that Jesus can do great things through us too. We have the power that he has given to us. Now, oftentimes when we talk and we use the word perfection, we use it as a noun. The condition or state or quality of being free or as free as possible from flaws or defects. Perfection. Perfect. And when it comes to Jesus, Peter, like all of us, if that is our standard, is not ever going to fully measure up. But there's a difference that I want to point out in how we as followers of Jesus, and particularly as good Wesleyan Methodists, can use this word perfection. See, John Wesley used this word perfection as a verb and not a noun. For him, perfection is an action, or actually a series of actions, that corrects our flaws and corrects those imperfections over time as we grow and as we learn more in the faith. Moving on towards perfection, he would say. That is what Jesus is doing with the disciples. That is what Jesus does with Peter and is doing with us. And we have this example from Peter of how it can be done. It's a process of trial and error, learning from our mistakes, teaching and correction, and sometimes even a little bit of righteous admonition to push us to be better than we ever think that we could be. Another example from the Gospels in Matthew 14, we get the story of the disciples who are out on the boat in a storm in the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus, who is not with them on the boat initially, comes walking on the water towards them. And Peter, along with the others, they are afraid. And they even think Jesus is a ghost. But Jesus tells them to take heart, for it is him. And that is when Peter says, "If it is you, Lord, then tell me to get out of this boat and walk to you." And he says, "Come." But then, as Peter steps out of the boat, and he begins also walking on that water towards Jesus, he gets distracted. He gets frightened. And then he begins to sink. And he cries out for Jesus to save him. Now Jesus pulls him up and gives him the often quoted scripture phrase that we have, "O ye of little faith." That is, if we use the King James Version. But then Jesus follows that up with another question. "Why did you doubt?" Jesus, at this point, is asking that question. Why is Peter doubting not Jesus, but doubting himself and his own faith to follow Jesus, and therefore leads him to sink? Peter wanted to believe. He wanted to come out, and he wanted to walk on that water as Jesus walked on that water, and for a moment, he did. Peter had the power. But then, fear and doubt crept in the midst of the storm, and then he lost it. But Jesus brought him back. Being a leader, whether it's like Peter or anyone else, especially in the midst of these times, is not easy. Particularly where crowds are bombarding you, storms are rising up against you, all while the boss seems to be away. But in fact, it is the power that Jesus gives to Peter and the power that Jesus gives to all of us that can actually help us to be a force for that change and that good in the world, and to help others discover that power as well. Now, one of my favorite movies, going back a few years now, is, it's a sports movie, of course, the movie Hoosiers. And there is so much that is compacted into that story. It's probably some people's favorite out there, too. And Gene Hackman, who plays the head coach, and Dennis Hopper, who we see in the picture here, is the assistant coach. But Dennis Hopper, his character has a problem. See, he is a genius when it comes to his knowledge of the game of basketball. A genius. He sees things that other people cannot see. But his flaw is, of course, that he is an alcoholic. And he cannot control his drinking. And most people in the community wrote him off just simply as that. But the coach saw something in him. And he wanted to help him, and he wanted to give him a purpose that he needed. And so he gave him that purpose by making him an assistant coach and trying to give him the confidence in order to not only give up his drinking, but to show out how his knowledge could work with the boys on that team and how it could make him and them better. And if you're familiar with the movie, you would see that he would get himself ejected from a lot of games in order that he could turn the game over to his assistant and get him to shine through. Now he tries it the first couple of times and he fails. But eventually, as the movie highlights, he finally gained the confidence and was able to lead the team to a win. But the key here is that he kept letting him fail, knowing that his failures weren't about just what he did, but also about what he didn't do. And he could only become more perfect by experiencing those things and learning from them. And he did. He embraced that perfection, not as a noun of something that is, but as a verb of working towards something that can be. And that is what we are all called to do as well. See, our story of Peter and John healing this lame beggar illustrates that we can be better and even our best selves through the power of God. We're being made perfect, and God has given us the power to bring that perfection into this world right here and right now. The question is, do we believe that we can actually change the world? I think we can. And more so, I think we must, for Jesus' sake. Now more than ever, as we have faced this health crisis and the obstacles that we have encountered with COVID-19, and again, as we confront the issues of race and discrimination in our world, a new opportunity is arising for us so that we can seize the power and be and make changes for the good. We can move this world, even though it is not as fast as we would like. We can move this world towards a more perfect image of the kingdom of heaven. But it means that we must take courage, and it means that we must have faith. The problem in our society when it comes to bringing about these changes is that we think, or more so, we have been conditioned to believe that nobody is perfect, at least in terms of a noun or an adjective. And no matter what we do, we will never be perfect. So why even try to make it perfect? Now, just like I talked about in that evaluation form that I shared earlier on, if we are told and we are led to believe that the only reason that we do things is to tell someone what they're doing wrong and that they cannot do, then we never will and we never can expect anything more from anybody else. But notice that even Jesus, when he is with his disciples, even when he rebukes them, his admonition comes from what he has told them that they can do and that they don't, versus telling them what they cannot do and that they shouldn't try. Jesus wants the very best out of them, and he tells them that, yes, they can. And they will be perfect because he has made them perfect in himself, just as Jesus is making us perfect and leading us to transform this world into a more perfect one through himself. And part of that transformation is about also acknowledging that we have the power to do so, but also knowing what it is that we have. When Peter says to the beggar, "What I have, I give to you," he is acknowledging to this man that he doesn't have what this man is expecting to receive. But what he does have is actually something bigger, something greater, and will alleviate the need for him to beg in the first place, because no longer will he be infirmed, because now he can actually stand up and walk. That is the transformation. That is the power that God gives in order not just to make things better, but assures from that moment on, things will be different. In these last few months, I don't need to tell you, things have been different. Just from the very fact that I'm standing here coming to you in this way right now, we know things are different. We have been asked to sacrifice for the good of our fellow human beings, for the good of the world amid circumstances that could have torn us down. And while we must still deal with this, I think that we have proven here, at least in Michigan for now, that by us acting together, we have made a difference. And we are now seeing how the medical and the scientific community is coming together to look beyond our times of quarantine, so that a vaccine and treatments can be developed, moving us from staying in place towards healing. We have learned so much just in these last couple of months. But it is a process, and it's becoming more perfect all the time, even as we know that it is not yet perfected. Another thing that I have noticed is that as we look toward reopening, and I will put that in quotes, a lot of things that I have seen about how we could reopen, whether it is from the businesses that we see going right now to our schools, even, yes, when we talk about our churches. A lot of those reopening things that we talk about are about going back to what was already before, but just with a few differences here and there, maybe a few minor inconveniences. Now, certainly there are things that we do look forward to doing again, such as gathering together, even here for worship. But what this time has confirmed for us is what we've already known to be true. We can't go back to the way things were before. We have to move forward. And we have to accept a new reality. And then we have to work towards perfection in that reality. Even here, as we have been doing our worship online, which was our original intent all along, we have a new group of followers who have been watching us here. And maybe some of you are watching right now, participating in our video series, our weekly studies, who cannot be here with us in person. Now, we have always had this power before this pandemic hit us. We knew it here at the church, and we knew it was untapped, and we needed to explore that. And thank God we did, because we were prepared when this pandemic hit, that even if we weren't perfect in the beginning of starting our online services here, we have become more perfect in this online world. And we know that no matter what happens, we cannot go back or should not go back to bringing our message out to the world at large. Because we know that no matter what, lest we miss an opportunity to continue to minister to new people and connect with others we never would have before, we cannot miss that. Newburgh Church, in the midst of this, is actually growing because we have seized upon this opportunity. We as a society and we as a community, in the midst of all of this too, have had to confront once again the social ills that have plagued us, as we've seen a renewed effort for advancement in the Black Lives Matter movement. In this, we have exposed so much of what has been going on in policing, but also in our own efforts. We've had to confront our own biases and our own prejudices, and also our own fears. Fear of speaking out. Fear about what others might think of us. Fear of retribution. Fear of not knowing what social change might actually look like in the future. And yes, fear of confronting those who don't want to change and have been deluded into believing that everything is fine just the way it is, even though we know that it isn't. But here's the thing. We have the power. We have the power of God in the risen Christ to make a change in this world. And we have the backing of the Holy Scriptures, which calls us to make that more perfect world a reality. And as justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, as the prophet Amos wrote, or as the prophet Micah says, "What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God?" It's right there in the prophets of old, and it is right there in Jesus himself. To do, a verb, to make this world a more perfect place for all of God's children, we have the power. But like Peter, who was at first afraid and lacked the confidence, and may have even been told by others that he could not do it, God's healing, God's justice, and God's love is not measured scale on a scale of 1 to 5, but through the ability for all of us to love God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, and with all of our strength. And as Jesus says, to love our neighbors as ourselves, the greatest commandment. Peter learned this, and then he began to live it. We can And we too must learn and learn to live it. And when we share that power, we can lead with integrity, we can speak of true perfection, and most of all, we can be the true body of Christ in this world, where when we talk about the church, people do not automatically think about what it is that we say they cannot do and how bad people are in this world. But we can change that conversation to talk about the church being the place that enables people to unlock their gifts that God has given them and what they can do through the power of God and how God enables us to transform the world and to heal this world and how good this world can all actually be. More perfect than it was before through the power and the gifts that God has given all of us. We have that power. Now let's go out and use it. Amen. Friends, we want to thank you again for joining us here today online, and we look forward to seeing you in many of our other ministries here this week and in future weeks again. And now, may the God who has given us the power to transform lives in the world, because through God's only Son, Jesus Christ, has transformed our lives and our world, go with us and be with us and guide us to get about that work, knowing that we can do all things through the Christ who has strengthened us. And may we take that grace and power and share it for God's sake and for the love of Jesus Christ in this world. Amen.
Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the keys that set us free? He paid it all to bring us peace. Jesus, only Jesus.
Dust may beating hearts. You love.